A show of hands. Those that were not expecting this. Well, if the reason is that brain surgeons aren't supposed to do stuff like this, then I must say you're already biased. Now that we've broken the ice, what I'd like to do is together break this word impossible. What I'd like to do is for us to go on a journey where we achieved something considered impossible, but using thinking that's so basic that we use it every day in our everyday lives, no matter what we do. The phone rang. The voice on the other side said, "Dr. Jeelani, we need your help. We have two healthy girls, just born, that are joint at the head. We don't have the skills or the infrastructure to take care of these girls here." Now, these types of cases are exceedingly rare. Only a handful of successful separations have been undertaken in the world, two of those in our unit. But there was a particular complication about this particular set. Their brains, the two brains, were intertwined, and a large part of each twin's brain was in the other child's head. How on earth could we separate the two brains and put them in their own cavities? Well, we did. And the following year, we did it again for another set of boys. Now, for me to take you on this journey of how we put their brains back in their own space, I need to tell you about my brain and the journey it took to find its own space. We were junior doctors when a friend, a colleague of mine, came to my room and said, "Would you like to accompany me to Glasgow? They have an introductory weekend program for a master's course in medical law and ethics." My first thought was, why on earth would I want to study about law and ethics? We have just finished 5 years of medical school, and frankly, I had no interest in studying anything ever again. But before I could voice my thoughts, I saw the light. The light was coming through the window, reflected off his shiny new car, a car that I'd been wanting to drive for some weeks. I had a light bulb moment, and I said, "Of course, but it's a long way away. We should share the drive." And this is how I found myself in Glasgow, learning about law and ethics. The university had organized the weekend really well. We had actors on stage, typically three at a time. One actor played the patient, one was the doctor, and the third actor did the voiceover for the ethicist or the lawyer. As the weekend went on, it became increasingly clear that there was something amiss. I started to feel uneasy because I could identify with the doctor really well, but not so much with the patient. What's more, I could have identified with the patient better when I was 18, before I had started medical school. It's nobody's fault, really. This is known as the curse of knowledge. Simply put, people with a certain knowledge cannot think like people that don't have that knowledge. It felt as if I had lost part of my innocence as a human being in becoming a doctor. I was disappointed, and I took the course. This was my first in-your-face experience of unconscious biases and how entrenched they are within all of us and how they distort our thinking. Fast forward some 4 years, and I found myself lost. I believed that love conquers all, but here it hadn't. So I did what a lot of people do when they're lost. I went to business school. I had a wonderful year. I gained some lovely friends, some lovely memories, and a large mortgage without a house to show for it. Towards the latter part of the year, we had to choose our optional modules. And as I was going through the booklet, I read this module, this class on strategic ambiguity. Hang on. These two words, strategic ambiguity, do not go together. Certainly in my world, people ask questions when they want to arrive at an answer. I could not imagine why people would ask questions and invest energy in making answers less clear. So out of curiosity, I took the course, learned a lot, and there we were. So armed with this knowledge of biases, conscious or otherwise, and strategic ambiguity, I came back to my world of 80-hour weeks working as a children's brain surgeon. Now, let's come back to the task at hand. We're talking about these two kids. The first thing I'd like to do is take the word impossible. I believe that impossible is a rather inaccurate word. Things that were considered impossible in the past, we do now. And things that we consider impossible today, a lot of them will be done in the future. So what I propose a better way to look at it is to call it highly improbable in the current time. Now, this is more than just semantics, because when you say impossible, it conjures a mental image of a wall, a big wall in front of you, impossible. But if you just change that to highly improbable, it's still very unlikely, but you may just be able to see a way through it. And different circuits start to work just by reframing the problem. Step two. Altogether, it seemed like an impossible task, but what if we break it down into possible steps? What if we deal with the skin? What could we do for the bones? What could we do for the brains? And then finally, how do we solve the problem of the blood vessels, arteries and veins? As a neurosurgeon, I deal with these things on a daily basis, as individual things, but never as a composite. So, break the highly improbable into smaller possible steps. Where does that get us? Here. So we've basically arrived from impossible has been converted into this, a decision tree. What next? This is where the human brain comes in. The human brain is a tool of prediction, period. And now augmented with AI, we're able to predict things with much greater accuracy. So, make the right predictions, execute, and you'll be able to separate conjoined twins at home. I wouldn't recommend you do it, but in theory you could. How do you make the right decisions? This is where my journey of lies and biases and how they distort our thinking comes into play. A general misconception about lies is that it primarily affects other people. Yet, the person we lie to the most is ourselves. And habituation to lies and biases changes the electrochemical architecture of your brain, and it makes your predictions less accurate. I was giving this talk at my daughter's school recently, and I had to summarize this for the millennials in their language into four words. So here we are. Hashtag, lying causes brain damage. Could somebody please make that go viral? Now, some people may argue that lying confers an advantage in certain roles, but this is not a TED talk on morality. I'm taking a purely utilitarian perspective here and lumping lies, biases, self-deception all together because they are distorters. They distort the optimal decision-making paradigms by allocating inappropriate weight to the facts at hand and make our predictions less accurate. Okay, let's go back to our example now. What we did was break the complex journey into multiple decision nodes, and what I'll do for the rest of the talk is pick on some of the decision nodes and talk about the main distorting influences that we had. Question number one, should the separation happen in the first place? Now, we see these two kids as two separate entities. But from the kids' perspective, they are born like this. They may have a different perspective. So don't succumb to familiarity bias. We would only undertake this work if we felt the odds were truly in their favor. One. Decision node two. Should I be doing the surgery? Biases that come right into play, there are the self-serving bias. These are super high-profile cases, and if they go well, it's a lot of kudos for the surgeon, for the team, the hospital, even the country. But remember, this is not about you. This is not about your team or your hospital or your country. This is about two children, period. Clarity of purpose is essential to maintain that focus. Decision node 3. Do we have the right infrastructure skill set to do this work? The problem that we have there is the blind spot bias. We can only see the world through our eyes. What we don't see, we don't see. How do you deal with this? Assemble a team around you, a multidimensional, multidisciplinary team with different perspectives. Empower everybody to think in such a way and interact such that you're able to see the problem through each other's eyes. The blind spots will start to disappear and your chances of success go up. We had this impossible problem that the two brains were interlocked. How do we separate them? As a brain surgeon, we could not see through this. This was impossible for us to see through. And this is brain surgeons around the world. But it wasn't impossible for my 7-year-old autistic daughter. She plays with Play-Doh. She makes shapes out of Play-Doh, different colors. The colors aren't allowed to touch. So what she'll then do is get a piece of cardboard and put it between the Play-Doh pieces and turn the cardboard such that the Play-Doh pieces are moved without losing shape. And that is what we did. We got a piece of plastic, put it between the two brains. There's a schematic in the middle. Here's the two brains with a silastic sheet. And then with every sequential operation, we gradually tightened it such that the two brains were gently pushed back into their own cranial cavities. Impossible? No more. I believe that every problem that exists has its solution already out there. What we lack is our ability to see it. Learn to think outside your silo. Next decision node. At one of the operations, we encountered a lot of bleeding. What we should have done is stop, regroup, come back another day. We didn't. We felt that we had invested so much into getting to that point, and it takes so much to get the whole team together to undertake work like this, that we decided to carry on, which in retrospect was the wrong decision. We succumbed to the sunk cost fallacy. Be aware of this, very common. The girls are now separated. We've done the job. But their outcome is not as good as expected. Now, every time I try and say this, I'm overwhelmed with a global response of people saying, Dr. Jeelani, please don't be so hard on yourself. You tried really hard. These are two separate things, not to be conflated. I am super proud of what my team achieved, but the girls didn't do as well as we had expected. What we tend to do more often than not is when reality unfolds, we retrofit and retroframe reality to fit our predictions. And whilst that makes for a comfortable today, cognitive ease, your prediction algorithms will not get any better. You'll make the same mistakes again, and we'll keep going around in circles, which we often do. Okay, artificial intelligence, where does that come into all of this? Well, we live in fascinating times. I need to go a bit sciencey for a minute to talk about AI. And I need to talk about a condition that's much more common called craniosynostosis. Here, children are born with misshapen heads, and we have to do big operations to reshape their heads to make space. So some 15 years ago, we invented some new distractors and designed an operation that was much more granular. We then studied a large number of operations using engineering, finite element platforms, and AI, statistical shape platforms, and having done that, this is what we can do now. We're able to predict with a high degree of accuracy the outcome of surgery without lifting a scalpel. And we can put all of this in a VR space. We take the parents into that VR space, show them their child's head before the surgery. We go through the surgical steps, show them the shape of the head after the surgery, answer any questions they may have, and only then, once we're all satisfied, do we proceed with the surgery. It takes a lot of ambiguity and bias out of the whole value chain. We have these tools now. Knowledge rather than being a curse, becomes a power for empowerment. What I would ask of us is not to think of knowledge as power, but rather think of knowledge as an obligation to reduce the asymmetries around you. Because then, and only then, may we retain some of the innocence we all have as humans as we're gaining increasing amounts of knowledge. We need to break that curse. We're immensely fortunate to live in a world and a time where we get to choose what we want to do. If we want to do something that's really meaningful, instead of simply get one up on our fellow human, we need to lie less. We need to unbias our thinking. The answers will become clearer, our predictions more accurate, and the highly improbable may just become possible. Thank you.